Hi, my name is Dave Frank, and welcome to my 35th Internet Masterclass. Tonight, I'm thrilled to be coming to you from the center of the jazz piano universe, the beautiful club Mesro in Greenwich Village, New York City. Tonight, this is where it's happening, folks. This is the most beautiful room in New York. It's so intimate. It's like everyone's your friend, and you don't even know what your name is. It's kind of like living in an apartment building here in New York City. Tonight, me and my closest 40 friends will be talking and playing, listening to the music of Keith Jarrett. We'll be listening to the music from Keith's classic recording with Charlie Haden called Jasmine. We'll take this ridiculous hat off now. That was good, though. Okay, now we're comfortable. First, I'll make my case about the greatness of Keith, and then we're listening to the opening track from the CD called For All We Know. I'll discuss the musical and pianistic concepts that I can understand from the recording. Then we'll listen to the recording again, and I'll talk you through the concepts in real time. Thank you for tuning in. Let's have some real fun. At this time, in this country, we need it. Yes, sir. My contention is that Keith Jarrett, born 1945, is the greatest pianist of the recorded era of music. My opinion is qualified by the fact that we can't know what Bach sounded like improvising after a couple of schnapps. Or we can't know what Chopin sounded like with his quintet. But my assertion is that Keith Jarrett is the greatest figure in recorded piano history, including such greats as Horowitz, Gould, Tatum, and everybody. There are, again, in my opinion, 100 reasons why Keith is the greatest. He is able to imagine, conceive, and perfectly execute super complex, multi-layered improvisations, each one thoroughly unique, complete, and original. He's the only jazz pianist that doesn't have a consistent style. Unlike every other player, his music, from concert to concert, year to year, can sound shockingly different. His musical brain can work and execute in multiple time and space continuums. Each time-space continuum has its own feel, its own touch, its own musical function and sound. And he's able to maintain these simultaneous dimensions, totally improvise the music that he's playing, and perfectly dream up, bring out, and control each part of his musical tapestry. His mind has access to these simultaneous musical planes to a degree not even dreamed of by any pianist before him. His brain is superhuman times 10. It says every other pianist in the world is an amoeba and he is Einstein. Nothing like a little artistic controversy. The scope of his improvisations is impossibly wide, from the simplest triadic movements to total dissonance, from rousing gospel to heartbreaking ballads, boogies, burners, blues, and every trio style. He plays the hell out of classical music. His singing melody line is light years ahead of any other jazz pianist, and he is able to separate his singing melody clearly from everything else that's going on. Harmonically, he is in a world by himself, the master of all standard changes, voicings, and reharmonization, and that's just for openers. He pioneered whole styles of piano playing, such as his incredible intros, long extensions, and many other signature improvisational styles that he invented. The words human and perfect are not supposed to be said together. Yet I have personally witnessed three-hour concerts where not only every note was perfect, but the way he played every note was perfectly played, projected, and balanced with all the other notes. At the end of 3 hours, you'd be exhausted, and he'd play his final encore. Every note would be perfect. He'd put this note over here, balanced everything. Just incredible. Keith is thinking on stage alone or with a trio in front of thousands of people of multiple layers of music working perfectly together, creating them all on the spot and controlling the sound of each layer of music perfectly. To me, this by its very nature is a conception that defies human comprehension and places him in a class by himself. Keith doesn't just improvise great jazz. He improvises multi-dimensional universes, each dimension balanced and controlled to perfection. His playing is like a blind man hitting a target from 2 miles away, and he hits it practically every time. We're just scratching the surface as to why Keith is the genius pianist of our time. The only way I can make sense of anything like Keith Jarrett is to remember that people like Beethoven and Bach also existed. That rare human beings have the divine potential to create works of art that totally transcend the achievements of the ordinary or super ordinary men or women. I've sat in Carnegie Hall and literally had my breath taken away by one of Keith's beautiful ballads. It's so beautiful that you hold your breath and time is suspended. That's a truly unique experience. It's always incredible to experience how great greatness is. Have I convinced you yet? I think a good artistic controversy is a lot better than a lot of the other ones we've been experiencing. So let's go at it. What we're going to do now is we're going to listen to the opening tune of Keith Jarrett's duo recording Jasmine with Charlie Haden. Although I could potentially do 100 classes on Keith's endless output of recorded greatness, I chose this recording to look into tonight due to its extremely pared-down nature. I think it's a good way to begin to understand some of the general concepts of Keith's playing. It's always important to remember that no after-the-fact analyzation can ever account for the spontaneous creation of beauty we hear in the great recordings by the great jazz artists. Somebody like Keith Jarrett has access to dimensions of musical creation that us ordinary mortals can never understand. It's just my hope that by delving into some of the concepts that informed Keith's playing to my own limited ability, it can serve to enrich us all in our own creative processes. Let's listen to the great Keith Jarrett and Charlie Haden playing For All We Know from the CD Jasmine.
When was this recorded?
What's that?
When was this recorded, do you think?
I'm not sure. It's a good question. I have to look it up. Thank you. Did you like that?
Yeah.
Yeah, awesome. Okay. Lenny Tristano used to tell me that the piano is just a pile of junk. He had a good piano, too. He used to say that. And he always followed that up with saying that the way most people play it, that's the way it sounds. a little intimidating if you're 16-year-old at the feet of Tristano. But anyway, he told it like it was. But when Keith Jarrett plays it, this pile of junk becomes a transparent window to the divine presence. Let's look at some of the stylistic elements that Keith is using during this sublime performance. One of the incredible innovations of Keith's jazz playing is the concept of musical layering. Keith assigns the various elements of music, melody, rhythm, and harmony, to specific locations within his two hands. He's just got this pile of junk and 10 fingers. Each layer of the music he's creating has a separate function, a separate touch, a separate time feel. Keith, in addition to innovating this concept of playing jazz piano, is able to improvise the music in each layer simultaneously, maintaining the integrity of each layer separately and blending each layer perfectly with the other layers to create a complete musical landscape. In the tune we just heard, Keith set up a musical landscape that had essentially three layers. Now here we have a semi-professional diagram of the hands and the piano. And we have basically three layers of music going on here. The first one is the melody in the top of the right hand, usually around this range of the piano. Most times he'll play the melody in the top of the right hand, like most pianists. Sometimes he'll move it around. But essentially, the melody has its own feel, its own sound, and it's usually happening on the top of the right hand. The second layer is his left-hand thumb. This guy has the wackiest thumb that has ever been thumbed. He told stories that he used to sit at his desk in school and stretch his thumb out on the desk, and people didn't know what he was doing, but he knew what he was doing, and that's his thumb. This one little thumb is capable of like a whole string section of an orchestra. So what you can hear, if you listen, and I'll point it out, is that the melody is up here in the right. The thumb has its own function. The thumb is playing the time like the pulse. So the thumb is playing more or less. It has some variations because anything Keith does has gradients and changes. But in general, it's fun to look at it, that the thumb has a counter melody to the melody in the right hand, and he's also playing this on the pulse. One, two, three. So this thumb here has an even time feel, more or less. Then the rest of the left hand is playing a great voicing. So just instead of playing just a melody and a left hand, he's thinking in three layers: melody, thumb, and the rest of the hand. This is cool because as pianists, we only have two hands. And if you can do three things at once, it sounds really cool. And Keith usually has at least three things, if not, who knows how many. But the incredible thing is he's, first of all, able to conceptualize the piano in such a way that everything is separate, it has separate functions. It doesn't stay that way all the time, but basically. And he controls each of the layers perfectly. So the thumb has its own sound, and he keeps that sound through most of the piece. The right hand has its own sound, and the right hand has a certain time feel, and the left hand has a totally different time feel. Listening to him play is like listening to watching a guy playing tennis in New Jersey and New York at the same time. Okay. I'll demonstrate a little bit of this to my very limited ability. Apologies, Keith. Haha. But I'll just show you kind of what it sounds like. So in the left hand, let's say we have this tune For All We Know. And so he puts a chord here, and then he has the thumb of the left hand hitting in quarter notes. and it's making a slow melody. That's what's going on in the left hand. So you see there's like a steady, more or less of a steady pulse. One, two, three. It's like a clock ticking, except it's not exactly that perfect all the way because he doesn't want it that way. But he creates this kind of a sensation that there's time. This gives you a feeling of time. Time is moving, time is passing. So you just feel that basic element of time, like life moving. In the right hand, he's totally free of what he's doing in the left hand. In the right hand, where he's playing the melody, he's playing behind the beat, on the beat. He's shifting his rhythm so that it's not in the same time universe as the left hand. Give you a little basic demonstration. One of the cool things that Keith is doing, and if you see him in concert, you realize this immediately, he's not only playing the strike of the note, he's not just playing the note, he's playing the note and he's playing the ring of the note as it rings. So most pianists will play the note and then go on to the next note. He's not thinking that way. He's playing a note and he's playing the ring. He's listening to the ring. Sometimes when you hear him play, it almost seems like he's doing something to the note after he plays it, which is of course impossible. But what he is doing is he's playing the ring, the sound of the piano. It's beautiful. So he has some notes ringing, usually, and some notes holding, and some notes moving. Some notes ringing and some notes moving. It creates this tapestry of piano, so you have multi-dimensional layers. So the right hand would be moving, and he switches it off. Now he holds, the left hand moves. This one he's listening to the ring of the note and knowing exactly when to start the next one. You see, the left hand melody moves slowly. Background, the melody will move at a totally different rate, and he'll sometimes go behind the beat. And he's listening to the ring and playing the ring. Okay, so you see, it's a whole other way of thinking. Pianistically, because there's so much more to listen to. You're not just thinking about the notes you're playing, but everyone is ringing. So he has this one ringing here, this one moving here, two or three ringing here, one moving here, and he keeps it all together. And he's creating the music at the same time. So he's creating all the notes, and he's controlling all the different layers, and each one has like a different Einsteinian time gradation that only he can hear. And he can do this in front of thousands of people. And it's just incredible, just amazing. Okay. The subtleties of Keith's melodic line are exquisite. You get from his playing often this exquisite sense of rising and falling. And he just, it's so subtle that it's amazing, but he just lifts you and then puts you down. Sometimes he lifts you up, up, up. You can't even imagine how far he's lifting you up, and he keeps going, and then he'll just bring you down a little bit like this. And so that's done by like an increase of energy in his playing. So it's these subtle movements that he's hearing. Again, I'll just try to do a kind of a basic thing. But it's not only notes. It's rising and falling of emotion all the way through. He brings you up to peaks, and then he takes you down to a valley like this. It's like the, phases of the moon, but it doesn't go in a regular rhythm like that. He does it all on the spot. He improvises it. He'll feel when to take you up a little bit, and then he'll bring you down a little bit. Then he'll take you up further. He's totally doing this at all times. So let's say we start in a kind of a trough. Now he'll bring it up a little bit. Now we'll bring it down a little bit. Bring it up. See, and he changes the time, so he might play something evenly. Bum, 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 bum. Then he'll change it. Bum, 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 bum. See? Rising and falling. He's doing this all the way through. It's absolutely beautiful. Okay. He's constantly shifting the weight and the rhythmic nuance of the melody, creating, along with his left hand, a mesmerizing sensation of this rising and falling. When we did the class on the Grateful Dead, to go off on a tangent, they were also doing this rising and falling. A lot of great music has this quality of rising and falling, but Keith is doing it measure to measure, rising, falling, and you can feel it. It's amazing. Okay. Just in terms of his improvisation, most of the tunes on this record are ballads. And Keith's way of improvising on the tunes during the blowing sections is to create what we call a new melody against the changes. Most of the time when you're playing jazz, you'll try to create like an eighth note line against the changes. That's kind of typical jazz improvising. But Keith didn't want to do that. He wanted to create essentially a new melody. So what makes a melody like For All We Know, is that you can sing it and there are lyrics, and the notes frequently pause. In the typical jazz line, it flows, it flows, it flows, it's beautiful. But when you're creating a new melody, which is a great way to improvise over ballads, you're thinking of like you're on a ladder and you go up a couple of rungs of the ladder and then hang. And then go down a few of the rungs of the ladder and then hang. And then you jump up a few and hang. So it's like a melody, something you can sing, but he's creating it on the spot. And so again, you can hear it, it's something like this. See, I'm thinking of not going on too long. Here's my pause, I'll go up the ladder, come down the ladder a little bit, maybe jump around a little bit. But it's like a melody. That's a style of improvising on ballads that you can try on your own. It's actually kind of fun and it's very relaxing and it gives you a chance to hear that ringing and play with the ring as well as the sound. Okay, all we just discussed is part of the fantastic acoustic music. There is also Keith's incredible comping during Charlie's solo, the beautiful extension at the end, and much more. I thought by outlining Keith's creation on this piece, just to whatever degree I could, it could help us a little to appreciate again the genius of the man, and perhaps give us all some useful concepts in our own music making. You cannot listen to Keith's music without invoking the name of your favorite deity. Oh God! Oh God, Krishna, Krishna, Buddha. Buddha, Jesus, Krishna, Buddha. As my great teacher Paramahansa Yogananda says, the divine often chooses to express itself in the form of music. Keith's playing is the obvious expression of a higher power of beauty, depth, and grace, in the world of Trump, no less. Let's listen again to Keith playing, and the excellent Charlie Haden played great on this, of course, too. This is For All We Know from their CD Jasmine, and I'll just point out some of these concepts as we're listening, and maybe it will make sense to you. You can hear the thumb in the left hand creating its own little melody. The melody in the right hand is playing in its own nuance of rhythm, but the left hand is playing in a different rhythm. He's controlling the top note in the left hand, and it has its own distinctive sound throughout the whole thing, and the rest of the left hand sounds like something else. And he's doing it to consciously rise and fall. It's like every note has his complete attention. He's hitting every note just the way he wants to do it, and it's different than the others. See how it's lagging behind in the right hand a little bit? Left hand is steady. Beautiful melodies in the right hand, just new melodies. He just lets his feeling go. When he feels it, he goes higher, he goes lower. He takes you up, he takes you down. He's playing around the melody. This is what we call an embellished melody. He's playing with the melody, but he's adding notes or subtracting notes. He's varying the melody, but you can hear the melody. Listen to the balance of the note in the right hand compared to the whole left hand. The left hand, the notes are bigger, fatter, and they have more vibration to them. He's still able to bring the right hand out totally above the left hand, and the left hand's doing two separate things at the same time. So now he's going to solo, and he's going to create new melodies against the changes. Yeah, the left hand is so cool the way he plays the thumb. This is like 1/1000th of what this guy can do. This is like all of the greatness is just distilled into something like this. But I thought it would be good to listen to this first. Sometimes in concert, he sings the thumb note. Right hand's very interpretive. The rhythm is not strict at all. Each one has its own emotion. Every note held, done to a turn. He's bringing it up, bringing it down, just a little bit. Nice voicings in the left hand. Ah, holding the ring. Ah. Left hand went staccato there for a second. Yeah. Little bluesy thing. Mm-hmm. space, this incredible sensation of space everywhere. It's not even the music, it's the space that's so cool. I mean, the music is cool too. That's it, the distilled essence of music, right there. He figured it all out. He's taking three notes and just playing three notes in all different kind of ways here. Beautiful. Now listen to his comping. He immediately brings it into another register. Listen to how he's bringing out the top note above all the other notes in this comping chord. Beautiful melody he's playing in the back behind the solo. He's creating that melody on the spot. Notice the balance. Look how Charlie's playing is here and Keith puts his playing perfectly beneath it. And beneath it, he's so quiet, but still the top note of the right hand is still coming out more than the rest. And it's just a gradation of light. This is a beautiful melody. He's using imitation here. Doo-doo. Beautiful. Incredible tone. Let's bring it up. Solo a little bit. He's beautiful three-note melodies, simple as can be. Here's our melody. He's going to embellish it. He'll put some little nice fills in the cracks in the melody. He'll add notes to the melody. That's what we call embellishing. Here's the melody again. So nice, the way it comes in and out. Brings it up a little bit, just a little down. Yeah. It's beyond human. He said he was trying to surrender to the mood. Melody's lagged time-wise. Left hand is more or less on the beat. He's bringing it up. Beautiful chord in left hand. There's that thumb. Boom, boom, boom. He's bringing it up high here. Using coupling notes in the right hand, which is one note beneath the melody. Yeah. Ooh, three notes play differently, same note. Now you think it's gonna end. Little tag. Oh, so he has a tag. That's not all. Melody. Every note played differently. Now, you think it's going to end? He takes you on another whole journey here. Now the melody in the left hand, it's played perfectly, just like it was in the right hand, but it's in the left hand. Now he's going to take you up to heaven, one rung at a time. Higher, higher. Thank you. That's some music. That's some music. Before closing, I'd like to thank a bunch of people who've made this great day possible. First, thanks to Keith Jarrett for a lifetime of sacrifice and dedication to enrich our collective souls with his incredible music. Thanks to Spike Wilner for giving us Mesro as a place to live our jazz dream. Yeah. Thanks to my wife, Hari, for her patience and support. Thanks to my tremendous videographer, Rick Steinberger, at Infusion. Yeah, man. We've done the last few projects together. We did one recently with Pat Martino. We got a chance to spend a whole afternoon with Pat. And Rick did just a great job. He's available for bar mitzvahs, weddings. Divorces, elections. If this kind of thing wets your sponge. I invite you to visit the Masterclass Archive at www.davefrankjazz.com. There are now 35 classes in depth, all of them free and long. On a flurry of jazz subjects, such as Bill Evans, Chick Corea, Oscar Peterson, Lenny Tristano, Dick Hyman, Beginning Jazz Improvisation Parts 1 to 4, Marx Brothers, Walking Bassline, Eric Dolphy, Charlie Parker, and much more. If you have any questions, comments, criticisms, complaints, or tomatoes, feel free to write to me at dave@davefrankjazz.com. My secretary, who will most likely be stoned, will probably delete your emails as soon as she receives them.
It's not me.
No. Blessings, and keep swinging from New York City! Thank you so much for coming out. God bless.